Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. This topic of today, this eschatological discourse of Jesus, much longer than we had just in our short paragraph in the Gospel of today, is a very difficult topic. If there would be not there somehow in force, I would skip it, because it's very difficult to talk about the things which we do not know. God is preparing us surely for our dying, and everybody of us will experience the end of life here on earth. I remember when I was very first time sick for malaria, and later when I recovered, they told me they were already talking about buying coffin. I can remember that like someone was taking life out of me, and there was no way to hold it. There was no way to resist. In this way, nobody asks us when the time comes, and in my ministry, I have met people who are so declaring that they are ready and they want to go. They didn't go. That's God's time. That's God's decision. And there are also those who are protesting against dying, and you have no any influence on this. So just be aware and be rather focused on what you can do and not on these things which do not depend on us. This final discourse, the final teaching on the destruction of the temple, Jerusalem, and the end of the world was given by Jesus in the temple in the presence of both the disciples and the people, so everybody could hear it, so it applies to everyone. It marks the climax of Jesus' public ministry and puts a stamp prophet on him, on Jesus, once and for all. Insofar as he foretells future events concerning Israel and the nations of the world, something what we would like to know what lies in the future. The discourse began by some people remarking to Jesus about the splendid stonework and adornment of the temple, which was a cause of wonder even to its destroyers. Even the Babylonians and the Romans who were destroying, they were marveling with this building which they anyhow put to ground. Jesus replied by predicting that the time would come when not a single stone will be left on another, everything will be destroyed. This is what we have now in Jerusalem, is the foundation of the temple. There is no the Jewish temple. And naturally, the listeners wanted to know when it would happen and what signs they should look out for. In other discourses of Jesus, he gave more instruction, especially the Christians. When you see these armies coming from the north, go out of Jerusalem, hide in the mountain ranges. And the Christians were the only group who survived Roman invasion in Jerusalem in year 70, because they just followed what they were told by Jesus and they were protected. Luke has already presented apocalyptic teaching by Jesus in his gospel. In chapter 12, he gave warning about being ready at all times for the coming of the Son of Man, for the return of Jesus. So make sure you have fresh grace in your hearts, and then you are prepared, you are ready to meet whenever he appears. In chapter 17, he spoke of the danger of being misguided, misled by false prophets. For when the Son of Man, when Jesus returns, when he comes, there will be no mistaking his arrival. It will be like lightning on the sky. You cannot miss it. It will be obvious. It will be not hidden. In chapter 13, Jesus spoke about the desolation of the temple, destruction and desolation of the temple, and then also towards the end of the Gospel in chapter 19 about the destruction of Jerusalem. And in fact, the whole Palestine was totally destroyed and forbidden for Jews to return to rebuild for almost 2 millennia. So it was very severe punishment. Since Jesus had said so much, perhaps the disciples and others in his audience felt that the coming of the Son of Man, Jesus, and therefore the final manifestation of the kingdom, coincided with the destruction of Jerusalem. So Jesus was correcting, it's one of the signs, there might be these all signs which he predicted. Jesus gave this frightening prophecy in the temple, the heart of life and worship in Israel. Remember, at that time, there was the only one dwelling place of God. We have so many churches all over our state and our diocese with the tabernacle, with the dwelling of Jesus. That time, the dwelling place of God was only in Jerusalem, the only temple in the whole world. They had these synagogues all around, and there in this temple he's saying this harsh prophecy. The present building was the third temple, which had not been completed in Jesus' time. The very first one, you remember when King David intended to build, and no, your son Solomon will build, and it was a magnificent building. It was destroyed during the war with Babylon, leveled to the ground. After exile, when they returned, was the second temple, which was not that great in look. That's why it was plenty of disappointment. And just short before birth of Jesus, they started to reconstruct it. Its construction began under Herod the Great, the one who wanted to kill the baby Jesus, and was finally completed in AD 64, just before the Jewish war, which culminated in its destruction in AD 70. So it was completed something like 30 years after the death of Jesus, and so in some way they worked for nothing. Just that you see, if it's not done the will of God, this was punishment for rejecting Jesus. So the stonework was massive and absolutely impressive beyond compare. Joseph, who's a Jewish historian, says that the magnificence of the temple and its content constantly aroused wonder among believers, or the Jews who came to pray, and the visitors alike. Visitors, they were not allowed to enter. There was a court for Gentiles. They were not really allowed into the temple, but outside you can see how magnificent building this was. So grateful worshippers made wonderful votive offerings that adored it too. Why do we adore our churches? Why do we care for the churches? Because beauty is one of the appealing things to turn to God, to the offer of beauty. And that's why beautiful churches like somehow encouraging, inviting to come closer to God. And it's not forbidden. It was one of the wonders of the world, this temple. A shrine of immense wealth, but Jesus did not appear to have been impressed by it. And there's a good question, why? Because his kingdom is not of this world. The temple in Jerusalem was pointing to him. Our churches are pointing, churches pointing to the everlasting kingdom of Jesus. It's not of here. And that's why he focused on the real importance. So he told his amazed audience that it would be a heap of stones. And his prediction was fulfilled some 40 years later. So what are the warning signs and that you can identify them? Everyone wanted to know when such a disaster would happen and what would bring it about. And as Jesus usually went beyond the question, he was answering questions, but he dealt with the weightier matters, giving some more insights than only just direct answer. There is a clear two-level reading here, as Luke pleads with his church, just the very first generation of Christians, not to listen to false teachers. So this is what happened in 20th or 21st century. There is such cacophony about preaching, each church is preaching something else. It is not really the beginning of the story. It happened just after Jesus was gone. The early church was very concerned about false teachers. And Jesus warned Christians that many, practically in every generation, would come using his name and making false claims. That's why we are sticking to the apostolic tradition. This is what was always, everywhere, and uninterrupted believed. This is what is the ground for the searching for the true teaching of Jesus. Some would go so far as to claim to be the Christ, while other overexcited preachers would claim to know the timing of these events. And as we know, with Jehovah's Witnesses and others, they were correcting, and even the corrections were wrong. As Jesus said, no one knows when it will happen. Luke uses this Greek word kairos, referring to God, for the time. Hence, it is God's time, not our time. It's his time in his eternal diary, not the chronological time of historical events, what is possible only to see by our own eyes, by our own experience. So even so, preachers in every generation who mistakenly claim to be able to pinpoint the event, no one knows it. So there is very simple instruction coming from Jesus. Jesus said simply, refuse to join them. God is the Lord of history, God is the Lord of the time, and of the future lies in his hands. Last word belongs to God. Don't worry, he will have something to say and just trustfully cling to him. Human history will produce wars and rumors of wars and revolutions in every age. As you can see, even in our time, since the Second World War, there was not even one decade of time without war somewhere in the world. And Jesus said, until we turn to him, until we put our trust in his divine mercy, in his divine goodness, there will be never peaceful a time. There will also be natural disasters like earthquakes, plagues and famines, but none of these separately, nor all of them together, are signs of the end. And as we have experienced in the 20th century, 400 years ago in Europe there was this Black Plague, which devastated 30% of the population, and they thought that's the sign, that's the end. You know, it's God's time, and he will not fail to make us aware of it. Luke was probably referring to the Jewish War of AD 66 to 70 and the many wars and revolutions associated with the expansion of the Roman Empire, with their consequent plagues and famines. You know, the war, there is no really win, there are always casualties, there are always poor people and destruction left over. There was also the eruption in Italy of volcano Vesuvius in AD 79, which destroyed this famous, very splendid city, Pompeii, and other cities which are not long ago rediscovered. And Josephus, who's this Jewish historian, claims that even cosmic signs in the heavens happened before the fall of Jerusalem. So there were enough signs to disturb the early Christians. And we know, reading just the Bible, the New Testament, that even the apostles, they were presuming at the very beginning that Jesus would return during their lifetime, before they die. Eventually, they got it. No, it's not that quick. It's not that imminent return of Jesus. And they were preparing Christians to persevere and to be ready for his return. A more disturbing fact is that Jesus said that the persecution of his followers would begin before all this happens. So the disciples were to be more concerned about not capitulating to persecution than wondering about the end. So be aware of this, what you can do, and not this, what is beyond our control. Persecution was to be their lot from the beginning, and they must deal with it. It will begin with Jesus and his passion, and continue throughout the life of the church. These other signs would come and go. Just to give you one example, we have even in one of our Stations of the Cross during the Lenten time, when Jesus said this to St. Faustina, the cross, the opposition, rebellion against my message will be the sign for you that you are right road, proceeding right direction. Not peaceful dreams, not triumph and not success. And many saints are saying exactly the same message, that the cross is always the surest sign. And he said very clearly, don't be overreacting, as he pointed very clearly, the over-exaggeration and discouragement are the real blockage in the spiritual life. The last word belongs to God. So don't worry, no over-exaggerated anxiety, no discouragement, just proceed with this, what you know, in American way, stick to your guns, and then you will be fine. So the persecution would come because of Jesus, and they must witness to him. So it's not because of this church or that church, because of you, of me. It's because of Jesus. He is the target. He is the one who is opposed. Remember that the evil spirit doesn't care about us. He cannot do anything against Jesus, and because he knows Jesus loves us, so he will act against us to upset Jesus. Just see how it works, and just don't be surprised. Don't get it too personally on yourself. This was to be a fact of their existence among Jews and Gentiles, as the Acts of Apostles bear abundant witness to. Christians would have to answer to both Jewish and Gentile leaders for their faith in Christ. And this should be our worry, that grow in faith, pray to increase the faith, pray for the grace to understand and to be able to explain that this could be some kind of hint to those who oppose, that might see some stream of grace and convert. But there was nothing to worry about, because Jesus himself would be with them in his indwelling presence. He guaranteed, he promised them wisdom to confound their opponents. It's his promise, it's his invention. The apostle just wrote it in the gospel. So they are not to view these events as either disaster or sign of the end. They must be several things, and this is a different topic to gather the signs together. This persecution were to be a normal part of the witness for Christ. So Luke sounds a note of confidence in the final victory here. Just very practical approach, this Christian Catholic saying, offer it up. This means insert your prayer, your suffering, your opposition into the prayer of Jesus or into the suffering of Jesus. Make it immortal. Make it profitable. And this is what he is really looking for, that what we can do in a very practical way. You might just decide, I will be a generous person. You go out, home, and are wondering what these beggars are doing at my doors. You know, that you just promise, and God is allowing to challenge your decision that you will grow, that you will really become a generous person. I'm becoming a truthful one. And then challenge me not even leaving the church. What would you say? Would you still keep your promise to be more truthful like Jesus expects from us? So a more difficult aspect of persecution is now put forward, in that family members will betray each other under stress or threats, and some disciples will be executed as a result of this. So the division in the family, a very much divided time, pray for the unification, pray for the unity. Very simple question. How many friends do you have from the opposite party? That shows how the country is divided. And Jesus is the good shepherd of everyone, who he wants unity. You don't have to agree with issues, but the people who are still out of his sheepfold, children of God. Besides all that, they will be hated, and everyone on account once more on Jesus. It's not me, it's not personal against me, it's against Jesus. We represent him, we are like ambassadors of his, and that's where is the target. It's not against us personally. Yet God is not blind to these harsh realities and will take care of them ultimately. He can trust the one who determines eternal destinies. Just once more, remember, the last word belongs to God. No one can escape his judgment. And he said so clearly, your endurance will win you your lives. So it's clear invitation to grow in faith and to persevere in this what you have learned. Don't allow to be taken left or right from the official teaching of the church. Everything which goes with the catechism of the Catholic Church is right, is correct. Everything which directly opposes, it's not the church teaching. It's very simply to say it. Luke uses a Greek word, hupomone, for endurance, and he means the triumphant acceptance of suffering that can make it redemptive for ourselves and for others too. Just insert, offer it up to Jesus, and you might have your own private experience how powerful this prayer is. So disciples will need fortitude for coming days, yet both persecution and martyrdom will cause many of them not to live until the end, so until the end of the world. And it was beginning of the Christianity, the new saying, new proverb was coined, that the blood of martyrs, of those who died for faith, was the seed of Christianity. And it was really amazing when you look backwards to the history, the more the Christians were killed, the more they were persecuted, the more the church was spreading all around the world. So this persecution is not necessarily something negative, and even if it might be unpleasant and painful, but make sure that it's offered up and joined with Jesus. It is therefore more important to deal with the living for Christ now, seeking his kingdom, searching for his kingdom in our hearts, than in speculating about what might happen in the future. We do not have insight in the future. What we are charged, it's a present time, and we have to live for Christ now. And there is no much glory offered to the disciples, the followers of Jesus, at this stage of the kingdom. St. Faustina and many others, they were saying, this is time of war. This is time to prove that our disciples, the reward is on the other side. So don't expect too much here. The glory is reserved for the final stage of the Son of Man. As St. Paul was writing in his letter, that if we are becoming Christians for the hopes in this world, we should be the more pitiful out of all people, because this is not the stage of triumph, of success. So stick to your guns, be with Jesus, pray for the increasing of faith, increase your faith, and be witness to Him who has power to save us and to protect us from eternal evil.